Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning, good morning. It's a wonderful day to be at church, amen? Even a better day to worship the Lord, amen? Amen. Hey, let's stand up for a minute. Let's greet our neighbors, okay? While everyone's getting their way back to their seat, I have just a couple of announcements this morning. We're trying to keep the announcement short again, so if you would, just check the back of your bulletin. Make sure you check out everything going on this week, several meetings. Do want to announce, though, that the young adult group's meeting tonight, 5 o'clock here at the church. 5 o'clock tonight at the church. Where's Katie at? Katie has a couple of announcements here.
Good morning. I just want to say that I have the information and the applications for Toys for Tots with me today, if anybody's interested in that, or if you know somebody, see me after church. And also, I need some help this week on the 14th at noon, which is Thursday, to pack buddy bags.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay.
In the music room, I have a lot of words for the praise songs that are typed on paper, and I would like to clean those out. And if anybody would like some of those songs, I'd love to just give them to you instead of putting them in the wastebasket. So if anybody wants any, let me know, or just go back there on the left side of the big rack, and don't take the regular choir music now, but just those praise song words. Okay.
Do we have any other announcements at this time? Do we, Pastor Dave? Yeah, we'll get Katie in just a second. Do you have anything? Okay. Any birthdays or anniversaries? No? Okay. Katie, if you, oh, Shannon. Cool, cool. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Anniversary. 27. Congratulations. Yeah. One more, Kayla.
Mason's second birthday is Saturday.
Cool. Okay, let's sing happy birthday for everybody. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Stand down.
Good morning again. I'm here to remind everybody that next Sunday, November 17th, is an important day, Consecration Sunday. Immediately after the worship service next Sunday, there will be a catered luncheon in Fellowship Hall, which is not a potluck, so you don't have to make and bring anything, but you do have to make reservations. Consecration Sunday is about each giver's need to grow spiritually by making a decision to give a specific percentage of his or her income as a commitment to Jesus Christ. I think about my giving as a part of my spiritual relationship with God, and I am so grateful for all that He has given me. I connect with this church because I feel blessed to be able to help people through various missions and to be able to worship here with all of you. But I give for my own spiritual benefit because it brings me closer to God. If you turned in a reservation card for the celebration luncheon last week, you don't have to do another one today. In fact, you shouldn't. That probably confused things. So I'll now ask the ushers to come forward and distribute the Sunday reservation cards. And as Janie plays some special music, I'll give you a few minutes to complete your card. If you've already done your card, you may want to use this time for prayer or meditation on the question, what percentage of my income is God calling me to give? Shortly, the ushers will come back and pick up the cards, and to make sure we leave out no one, we will make contact this week with people from whom we do not receive a luncheon reservation card. So please help us out by completing a card. Thank you.
Anyone that did not receive a card last Sunday, please raise your hand and we'll get you one.
Let's all stand as the praise team comes up.
I think pretty much everybody knows this one. How majestic. Make sure you get your claps in here, okay?
Oh Lord, oh Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, oh Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh Lord, we magnify your name, Prince of Peace, mighty God. Oh Lord, God Almighty.
Let's do that one again.
Oh Lord, oh Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, oh Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh Lord, we magnify your name, Prince of Peace, mighty God. Oh Lord, oh God Almighty.
Sounded pretty good.
Let's offer this as a prayer to God.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, so I can walk in your truth. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Open my eyes so I can see the wonderful things that you do. Open my heart up more and more and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. All of the days of my life. All of the days of my life.
You know, there are times when it's easy to come in here and just think, okay, here we are again on Sunday morning. It's just, you know, another Sunday morning, same people, you know, pretty much know the routine. And then we think about the words of this song, where the Lord is, it is holy ground, and the Lord is here. So let's remember that as we sing.
This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and where He is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is here, and
if you would, open your bulletin and follow along with our call to worship. Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord. Praise the great name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of
the Lord. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Our first hymn this morning, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you.
if you would, open your bulletin and follow along with our opening prayer. Lord Jesus, you are indeed the ruler of all creation and worthy of our highest praise. Yet you know how easily we tend to forget that and instead bow before other thrones, even putting ourselves on the throne at times. So as we bow before you in worship this day, may our hearts be transformed that we might truly serve you in all that we say and do. Amen. Please be seated.
Except the kids, I'd really like for you guys to come up here if you would. Got a bunch here this morning. That's great. Good to see you guys. Good morning, Ashlyn. Yeah, you see that up there. Okay, well, he sees a picture up here that isn't up there yet, but it can be. So, hey, let me ask you, does anybody know what tomorrow is? It's a holiday. What is it? Veterans Day. Right. Does anybody know what a veteran is? Yeah? What? Someone who works in the war. Well, actually, that's close. Somebody who works in the military, like the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, you know, Coast Guard.
My friend's dad was in the Marines.
Your friend's dad was in the Marines? Well, my hat's off to him, and I salute him. But a lot of people, when they think about the people who serve in the Marines, you know, the soldiers that serve in the Marines, that's kind of what you think of, isn't it? The guys in the uniforms and the helmets and the guns and all of that, you know, shooting and stuff. But I want to tell you, there's a lot of other people in the military, in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, that do different things besides just going out and shooting. And I want to name some of them because, let's look up here. Well, do you have an idea?
My friend's dad goes out and it's clear for them to go out.
Okay, your friend goes out to see, friend's dad goes out to see if it's clear for them to go out. Yeah, that's a good thing.
My uncle right now, I think he's in certain place guarding.
Your uncle is in a certain place guarding? Okay, well, we appreciate his service. And let's look at these, because there are other ways that people serve in the military. What do you see happening here? Somebody's putting food on somebody's plate. You think soldiers have to eat?
Yeah.
Yeah, somebody's got to cook that food. There are cooks in the military. What's the next one here? Oh, what's going on here?
Drinking.
They're drinking something. Do you know what they're drinking? Who's this person way over on the left that you can hardly see? You see, as kind of a drinking holy water. It's like that. They're sharing Holy Communion like we do here in church. And the person there in the white with the purple, sash on there, that is what's called a chaplain. He's like a pastor, like me, but for all the people in the Army or the Marines and such. And that's a very important role too. And then we have, what's going on there? Yeah, there's a surgeon, there's a doctor, right? Yeah, the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, they all have doctors and they have nurses and, you know, they need people like that too. And now here's...
If somebody gets shot, they can heal.
If somebody gets shot, they can heal, but sometimes people just get sick. Even soldiers get flu bugs sometimes, you know, and they have to have doctors, so...
Sometimes they just have to get plain surgery.
Sometimes they just have to plain get surgery, yep. So anyway, they have those people. Now here's one more. What is going on there?
A band,
yeah. Do you know what? That is the Air Force Band. And the Air Force has a group of people who their service to their country is playing instruments and going around and representing, talking about the military and playing music to help make people happy. It's not just all about guns and shooting. In fact, my guess is that if you ask anybody who is in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, you ask them, do they want to shoot anybody? They would say what? No. They don't want to hurt anybody. They don't want to shoot anybody. They would much rather be playing music than shooting. But sometimes that's just necessary. And some people choose to do that. And we appreciate their service for our country. And we wanted to, this morning, I would like to just ask those who are veterans here, who have served or are serving, if you would please just stand where you are, because I have a question. Okay, now, yes, definitely. Can we get a microphone or a couple of microphones real quickly? Because I want to ask you what branch of the service you served in and what did you do? You know, were you a soldier on the front lines or were you a cook or a doctor or what? Dale, you want to start?
I was in the, excuse me, I was in the U.S. Army a year and a half in Korea and strangely enough in Graves registration.
Graves registration. All right. That's a hard job. Yes. Oh, you go ahead.
Got me.
Yep.
I was in the U.S. Air Force, and I was a dispatcher in the motor pool.
Dispatcher in the motor pool?
Yeah.
That means, yeah, people have to use the cars and the trucks and everything. And
they had to come through me to get any transportation that they needed.
Okay, very good. Thank you. And Don.
I was in the artillery, not as a truck driver.
Okay, he was a truck driver with the artillery. That's the big guns that, you know, like, kind of like cannons and stuff. Yeah, missile launchers that. Okay, go ahead.
I was in Vietnam. I was in artillery service battery,
mm-hmm.
resupply unit.
All right, resupplying the artillery, yeah.
I had 2 3-4s and 1 9-4.
Oh, okay.
I was in the Air Force in a tactical fighter squadron, and we trained pilots to go to Vietnam.
Okay, trained pilots. All right. And Lloyd, we don't have a microphone back here for you. Can we get one up here?
U.S. Army. Vietnam, I was a translator.
A translator? All right, so you had to learn different languages. Exactly, I couldn't have said it better. Well, we want to ask you to remain standing because I have something special. First of all, I want to offer a prayer for you. And for all of our veterans, and then I have something that I want you to give those folks, okay? So let's bow our heads for prayer. God, you ask us to serve you in so many different ways. And serving in the military is a calling that is not easy. And some would say that Christians shouldn't do it, and others would say, yes, they should. But like we said, don't know any soldier that wants to hurt or kill anyone, but we do want to protect people from harm. And so, Lord, we thank you for those who have volunteered and some who were called into service, even though they didn't especially want to go, but they served. And they served well, and we thank you for them and for all of these here this morning who have served us. And we pray your blessing not only on them, but on all of the military who are serving now, who are in places where it's really dangerous. And we pray for their protection. And we pray for all of the different people, the doctors, the chaplains, the cooks, the mechanics, everybody, that somehow they might all work for peace. And that we pray, Lord, that one day there might be truly peace on earth. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I want to give you something here because let's share with these people who have served our country well just a little something to say thank you. And we have, well, we need six people for six. Here, you want to just take one of these? Take one there. Take one. You want to take one? You want to take one? And You want to take one? And all of you, I think that's all of them that we have. Each of you want to find somebody that's standing to give one of those to, please? And then you guys can go with Tony.
From the Air Force, and my uncle died.
Wow. Yep. All right. Very good. Did everybody get one now? Yes? Yes? All right. Let's again thank them for their service. Well, there are lots of other thank yous too. Thanks to the Lord for so many different things. And so at this time, as we prepare to come before the Lord in prayer, I would just ask if there are any particular joys that you might like to share this morning. Yes, Tony. Look at this handsome guy coming down the aisle.
He's not here.
Your son is going back to work after just 2 weeks after surgery. Wow. I'm not sure that thing is on and working there.
Anyway, he's doing much better.
Good.
Still have a long way to go, but they're doing much better.
Very good. Thank you.
Like you.
All right. Any other joys that you'd like to share? Oh, Dorothy, here.
Saturday, I have a joy. I'm going to play with the Wabash Valley Area Band Saturday at the Danville at the Convention Center. We've been playing for years. Our band is very close. We have about 30 or 35 in it. And last year we had a tragic thing happen. Our lead trumpet was run over by his own tractor.
Oh.
And we miss him dreadfully. Mm-hmm. And our director now has left us and moved to Florida. But the good news is the director from Fountain Central High School has agreed to take care of us. But we're very close. We have a wonderful time. And our band has been going for years, and I've never seen anybody at Danville, Illinois that I know other than the band. And this festival tree is wonderful. It's for children. They have decorated trees and a contest which one wins, and then they auction them off to the highest bidders, and they decorate the building beautiful. Hmm. And they have all these trees and wreaths, and so it's a beautiful place to go. If you ever want something to do, it goes about 10 days.
Wow. Okay. Thank you, Dorothy. All right. Oh, Bill?
We had our anniversary yesterday, and for you who watch the religious channels on TV, you might be familiar with the Gaither group.
Uh-huh.
They're having a concert in Indianapolis in about 2 weeks, and Tony got us tickets to go.
Ah, very good. That'll be wonderful.
Today is two months since Mom has been passed away. Mm-hmm. And every day I've been struggling at work to get through and make it on to the next day. And the Lord has done that for me. And he's kept me going. So I'm very thankful for that.
Amen. All right. Well, thank you. Oh.
I just want to say that my granddaughter that lives in Georgia jumps, rides the horses and jumps the gates. She looks like Twiggy. She's 16. And so she's got grand champion in Venice, Florida yesterday. So I'm proud of her. And then the Puerto Rico government sent her an invitation to ride the horse in their festival starting November the 20th. She'll be down there 4 days.
Very good. Any particular prayer concerns that you have this? Well, do you have a Joy?
We're waiting moment by moment for a new grandbaby. Yeah. Due date was yesterday. Mommy's ready to have her here. Daddy's hoping for Tuesday, so the birthday will be 11, 12, 13. But anyway, we're waiting.
That's fun. I have a feeling it'll show up on Facebook real quickly afterwards, right? All right. Did you have one, Carol? Oh, concern. Okay. All right, Brenda, go ahead. You have the microphone. Go ahead.
I just want to pray for all the veterans who can't be here today.
Yeah, right. In fact, you know, that's a good point. And wanted to just draw your attention to the fact that in our bulletin, we do have at the bottom of the prayer list, says, please keep in your prayers our troops in active service. And just in case any of them happen to tune in to our worship service on YouTube, we want to give a shout out and a thank you to Major Jason Newman, Captain Tim Simic, Rob Graham, and also Lieutenant Colonel Kareem Taylor. And I'm not even going to take a shot at the last name. But yeah, thank you very much for their service, and you know, we want to remember all of them.
All right. Yeah, my father was a World War II vet.
Okay.
And my uncles.
Yep. Got a lot of people here that have relatives as veterans. Yes.
But right. To all the veterans, I just pray for them.
Yes. Agreed.
We have a friend, Shirley Howard, mm-hmm. who's having some heart issues and is in intensive care in Union Hospital. Appreciate her prayer.
I'd just like to ask for prayers for the country and all the people in the Philippines. Last count was 1,600, and they haven't even got back into the country, but that country has been devastated by this typhoon.
Yes, yes. Yes, and we may have information coming very soon about, you know, how we can help if anybody wants to assist. All right, any others? Well, as we prepare to come before the Lord in prayer, let's sing together this prayer chorus, Make Me a Servant.
Make me a servant, humble and meek. Lord, let me lift up those who are weak. And may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today.
Good morning, Lord. Well, we have already talked this morning about those who serve in the military and how grateful we are for their service. And as we come before you now, we remember that there are so many who serve in so many other ways. And I just want to say thank you, Lord. We all want to say thank you for people who serve in so many different capacities and who serve in your name, remembering always, Lord, that the reason we serve others is because you have first served us. that you made yourself a servant and humbled yourself and came to live among us. You gave your life for us that we might live, and we thank you. There are so many other thank yous that we've already lifted up this morning. For one who has been able to go back to work, Dorothy being able to play with the band, for anniversaries, for granddaughter winning the horse competition, for the anticipation of the arrival of a new life. So many joys, and we thank you for each one of them, Lord, and we thank you that you are a God who cares about each of those and about our concerns. And so we lift up to you, surely, and we lift up to you all others who are dealing with illnesses or injuries, health concerns, and we pray your healing touch on them. Oh Lord, we also want to pray for Dick Peel, who is down at the hospital in Terre Haute. We pray your healing hand would be upon him and that your comforting presence would be known to him. We pray also for those who are grieving. We think especially right now about the thousands, hundreds and thousands in the Philippines who are reeling from the impact of that typhoon, and we pray that help would come quickly and massively to assist in rebuilding and dealing with the grief and the loss. We pray for others who are grieving today, Lord, too, that your comforting presence would be with them and be very real to them. Lord, we also want to lift up again our veterans and for all of those who serve in the military. We pray for protection, and we pray that the day will soon come when no one has to lift up arms against one another, but that the Prince of Peace would reign everywhere and in all hearts. Lord, there are many other concerns that we have, and we offer them up to you in just a brief moment of silence. And we thank you for hearing all of these prayers in the name of Christ, even as we offer back to you the prayer that he taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
morning.
Morning.
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from 1 Samuel, staying on the line of servants. Israel is asking for a king. 1 Samuel chapter 8, verses 1 through 7. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as judges for Israel. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah. And they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not walk in Samuel's ways. They turned aside. After dishonest gain and acceptable bribes, they perverted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected. They have rejected me as their king." Chapter 9, verses 1 to 2. There was a Benjamite, a man of standing, whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel, the son of Zorah, the son of Becheroth, the son of Apheth of Benjamin. He had a son named Saul, an impressive young man without equal among the Israelites, a head taller than all the others. Then skipping to verse 15. Now the day before Saul came, the Lord had revealed this to Samuel. "About this time tomorrow I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin. Anoint him leader over all my people Israel. He will deliver my people from the hand of the Philistines. I have looked upon my people, for their cry has reached me." When Samuel caught sight of Saul, the Lord said to him, "This is the man I spoke to you about. He will govern my people." Chapter 10, verse 1. Then Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on Saul's head and kissed him, saying, "Has not the Lord appointed you leader over this inheritance?" And chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. Samuel's farewell speech. Samuel said to Israel, "I have listened to everything you have said to me, and I have set a king over you. Now you have a king as your leader. As for me, I am old and gray, and my sons are here with me. I have been your leader from my youth until this day. Here I stand. Testify against me in the presence of the Lord and his anointed. Whose ox have I taken? Whose donkey have I taken? Whom have I cheated? Whom have I oppressed? And from whose hand have I accepted a bribe to make me shut my eyes? If I have done any of these, I will make it right." "You have not cheated or oppressed us," they replied. "You have not taken anything from anyone's hand." Samuel said to them, "The Lord is witness against you, and also his anointed is witness this day, that you have not found anything in my hand." "He is witness," they said. Chapter 15. Ten to 11. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel. "I am grieved that I have made Saul king. He has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions." Samuel was troubled, and he cried out to the Lord all that night. And 24 to 26. Then Saul said to Samuel, "I have sinned. I have violated the Lord's commandment and your instructions. I was afraid of the people, and so I gave in to them. Now I beg you, forgive my sins and come back with me, so that I may worship the Lord." But Samuel said to him, "I will not go back with you. You have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you as king over Israel." Our gospel reading is Luke 22. Please rise for the gospel. Luke 22, verses 24 to 30. Talking about serving again. This is at the Last Supper. Also a dispute arose among them as to which of them was considered to be the greatest. Jesus said to them, "The king of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those whose authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like them. Instead, the greatest among you shall be the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves." You may be seated.
Kings, the kings of the nations lorded over them, and those in power over them call themselves by fancy names like benefactors. But it is not to be so with you. Let's pray. Jesus, you are not only the one who said that those who would be greatest must be the least, and those who would be counted as the top should serve at the bottom. And you not only said that, but you lived it out in your life. And so this morning, as we open the scriptures to hear that truth once again, we pray that you would open our minds and our hearts, that we might not just hear it, but that we might also put it into action in our lives. For we pray in your name. Amen. I got a picture up here, and I'm just curious as to whether any of you happen to recognize who that is. Would it help if I told you that he was a native of Terre Haute, Indiana? Okay. This is a man named Robert Greenleaf. And back in 1970, when he was 66 years old, Robert Greenleaf published an essay on leadership that he entitled "The Servant as Leader." And that one essay turned much of the business world on its head, because at that time so much of business was operating on a pyramid model, a pyramid structure, where those at the top exercise not only the greatest control over decision-making, but also control over the resources of the corporation. Greenleaf dared to suggest that, he had studied businesses and organizations for the last 40 years to see what makes them work, which ones work well and which ones don't. And he suggested in this document that those that were most effective were those that were founded on or built around a culture of what he called servant leadership, where the leaders of those organizations saw themselves first as servants of others, whose primary responsibility and greatest privilege was to help others to become the very best that they could be. And that was not only employees and not only customers of their companies, but also the communities in which those corporations were located. And in the last 40 years, much, if not most, of the leadership literature has revolved around that concept. Now, you and I know that that was not an idea that just originated 40-some years ago. Because if we read the scriptures, we see that it goes back at least as far as Jesus And I would suggest to you it goes clear back through the Bible, back into the Old Testament. And what we see in Saul and Samuel is a good comparison of the difference between a servant leader and one who leads in order to be served. During these 10 weeks that we've been going through the story, this journey through the Bible that we call the story, we've been learning how when God first created humankind, He created us so that we would live the kind of life that God had for us to live, so that we would show to the whole world the very character of God. And then we blew that, clear back at the beginning with Adam and Eve. And since that time, God has been trying to restore His people to Himself so that we might once again show to the world the character of God. And we've seen how God raised up different leaders to try to help in that restoration process, and how God brought the people into the Promised Land and said, here, this is going to be where my great experiment is going to have its core, here in the Promised Land. And for 300 years, from the time that the Israelites, the Jewish people, arrived in the Promised Land, they were led by people who were raised up by God, called by God to intervene in specific circumstances, you know, when the people were oppressed by other nations. But when that immediate crisis went, the leaders who were called judges then kind of faded into the background. And then the cycle kind of happened over again. And that went on for 300 years. Until finally we have one of the judges named Samuel, who is a priest. See, these judges were not just supposed to deliver the people from oppression. They were also to be spiritual leaders of the people. And Samuel, a priest, was a judge and a priest and a prophet. And he was a good one. But the time came when he grew old, and unfortunately his sons had made a choice. This is a tragic thing, but I know some of you know what it's like to have children who choose not to go the way that you have taught them to go. And Samuel was one of those. For whatever reason, his two sons who were serving under him didn't quite like the way that he was being a servant leader, and so when he appointed them as his successors, the people came to him and said, wait a minute, no, your sons don't follow in the way that you do, so we want to be like the other nations and have a king over us. And a problem came in. Because what God had called the Israelite people to be was not to be like other nations, but to be different. And in the Old Testament, the word we have for that is holy. Holy means separate, separate and set apart for a specific purpose. And God's people were to be holy. And yet here were God's people saying, we want to be like the other nations. And it grieved Samuel to the core. And he went to God and said, what am I supposed to do? And God says, Samuel, they haven't rejected you, they have rejected me. Now I'm giving you permission to go ahead and do what they've asked, to give them a king. But make sure you tell them that when you have a king, when you have this organization that has one person at the top of the pyramid, there can be real problems. Somebody has said once that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. He said there's going to be problems coming down the way, and you need to warn the people about that. So Samuel does. He says, you want a king? Here you go. And he presents a guy, you know, that God has chosen, who stands, according to the Bible, head and shoulders above everybody else. And the Bible says he's the most handsome guy in all of Israel. And so the people look at him and they think, oh boy, we got a winner. And then over time, people begin to see a little bit more what Saul is really like when the time of testing comes. Robert Greenleaf and many others who have followed him have talked about qualities of a true servant leader. And I want to take just three that I have seen in the literature that I've been looking at. I want to take just three of those and focus on them very briefly. And then I'll have a summary thought at the end. But the first quality of a true servant leader that we find not only in the work of Greenleaf and others, but also in the Bible, is humility. And I appreciate what the Apostle Paul says in his letter to the Philippians when he talks about this. For the people of God, there's a certain way, that certain attitude that we are to have. And he says this in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, "Do nothing from selfishness or conceit, but in humility count others as being better than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others." Very interesting how Saul started out. When he was first tapped by God, and they went through this process of casting lots to see, you know, which tribe of Israel should be chosen, and then out of that tribe, which clan and which person in the clan, and it finally fell to Benjamin. And Samuel says, "Okay, it's Benjamin. Where is he?" He was hiding in a bunch of supplies. He was scared silly at the possibility that he was going to be the one to lead Israel. And for me, I look at that and I think, you know, actually there's some hope there. Because at least at that point, he had the humility to realize, this is bigger than me. I can't do it on my own. And then time goes by. And Samuel becomes king. And he leads some very successful military excursions. And he gains some fame. And then comes one where he is called to go up against the Amalekites, who have been harassing the history against the Israelites went way back. God says, go up against them and destroy them. And Samuel does not obey. He destroys most, not all. And he's told not to do anything with the plunder, you know, not to take any of the animals for himself. But what does he do? He takes the best of the animals and he saves them. I'll get back to that in a moment. But the other thing that he does after he wins this great victory and Samuel goes to confront him, he can't find him. And God says to Samuel, well, guess where you're going to find him? He's just been up at Carmel. And he's erected a monument to himself. So much for humility. Count others as being better than yourselves and do nothing out of selfish motivation. Quality number two, listening. And that grows out of humility. A truly humble person who sees others as being at least as good as, if not better than themselves, is willing to recognize that God has placed in those people gifts and ideas and is always looking for, you know, where is the next good idea coming from? And who might have a different way of looking at this than I might? And so a truly humble leader will gather people around him or herself and listen to them. Now, listening is something that, I mean, I could do a series of sermons on listening. I'm not always so good at it myself. But listening is something that doesn't come naturally to most of us. We have to be taught. I loved it when my daughters and my grandkids showed up on my doorstep Monday, surprised the dickens out of me, a belated birthday gift. I had no idea they were coming. Knock on the door. There they are. What fun. We had a delightful time that day. But there was one time when little Daxton, he's 3 years old, we were in the house, and I had told him, Daxton, put that down, please. And he kept playing around with it. And his mother immediately said, Daxton, what did Poppy say to you?
And I'm thinking, that's no big deal, you know, leave it alone. He's my grandkid, right? She said, Daxton, what did Poppy say to you? And Daxton repeated it. And she said, what do you do when Poppy tells you to do something? And he puts it down. And she said, good listening. I really appreciated that, because we have to be taught to listen. And one of the things that Saul didn't do so well was to listen. Samuel, on the other hand, had been taught from early on to listen. And one of the things I love in the story of Samuel is how when he began serving in the temple, you know, he was a miracle child, and his mother dedicated him to the Lord and let him serve in the temple. And one day, when he was just young, he's lying down in the temple, and he hears a voice, Samuel. And he jumps up thinking that the priest Eli has called to him, and he goes to him, and he says, you called me, here I am. And Eli says, I didn't call you, go back, lie down. And this happens three times. And finally, Eli, you know, who may not have been the greatest parent or priest himself, he gets a clue. And he says, Samuel, wait a minute. Listen, the next time you hear that, if you hear it again, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. I love the fact that Eli took time to help Samuel learn to listen to God. And I would suggest to us that all of us, if we are truly going to be servant leaders the way Christ has called us to be, need to help each other learn to listen, and we need to listen well to one another. Like I said, there's so much more that I could say about that, but Saul, unfortunately, doesn't listen when God says, go up against the Amalekites, and here's how I want you to handle this campaign. He decides, you know, I have a better idea than God does. And he has to be confronted about not listening, and not only not listening, but not obeying. Samuel has to go to him and say, what did Poppy say to you? Third quality, integrity. Saul is now facing up to what has happened after he refused to do what God had commanded him to do against the Amalekites. Samuel has confronted him, and all that he can think of is saving face. And he says, oh, Samuel, don't walk away from me. Stand with me so it looks good for the people. You know, he's all about the image at this point. And I really appreciate what Samuel says shortly before that when he does kind of a farewell address. You know, Saul has been appointed king, and Samuel knows that he's kind of fading into the background. And so he invites the people to bear witness, and he says, listen, I want you to tell me, have I taken anything that doesn't belong to me? Anything of yours that doesn't belong to me? Have I oppressed anyone in any way? Have I tried to corrupt justice by offering bribes? If so, tell me right now. And everybody says, no, you haven't. And then Samuel does one of the most humble things, I think. You know, this has not gone the way that he intended, that he had hoped, and he's concerned about it. But then he says, no matter what has happened, I'm going to continue praying for all of you. I'll tell you, I want to be able to look back when the time comes that I'm fading into the background. Whether you call it retirement, whether you call it facing death, whatever, I want to be able to look back like Samuel and say, bear witness. Have I cheated anybody? Have I lied to you? Have I gone the easy way rather than the hard way of discipleship? I want to be able to stand before my Lord Jesus Christ and hear him say to me, well done. And I want to hear it from him.
Because, folks, he is the ultimate example of a servant leader for us. And we go just a little bit further in the writing that Paul had in Philippians there. And he goes on to say this. He says to the people of God, let the same mind be in you. Could you bring that slide up? Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was equal with God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even to death on a cross. And therefore, God has given him a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. When people see in us true servant leadership, the way we know it is true servant leadership is it always points back right there. And I pray that not only we as individuals might be known as true servant leaders, but we as a church might be known as a church that serves. Let's pray. Jesus, you have given us the example. Better yet, you have given us yourself. Teach us to follow in your footsteps, that we might be the servant leaders you've called us to be. For we pray this in your name. Amen. Well, out of gratitude for the gift that God has given us in Jesus Christ, let us offer to God our tithes and offerings. Join in the prayer that's in your bulletin. Jesus, as you came to serve us, so we would do likewise. As your servants,
We place both ourselves and our gifts before your throne. Bless us and our gifts, we pray, that all may be used for your glory. We ask this in your own holy name. Amen. A closing hymn, The Old Rugged Cross.
On a hill.
Let us also go from this place to serve him humbly, listening to what he has to say, and with lives of integrity. And let us go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.